Okay, so I'll now talk of the use of the contour-based approach for the positioning activity. So when you're talking the contour-based approach, we're going to be using the same contour seal that I talked about in the morning. We're going to generate the contours in a similar manner. Okay, so if you look at this, this is the skeletal structure that we have, what we are calling as the contour seal. From this, we are able to generate contours like this. This part is common in both the techniques. What we do is that once we've generated these contours, we can move the contours around using what I'll very crudely call very simple computer graphics techniques, which are similar to morphing techniques, but we are essentially first generating a new position of these contours. So in this case, if I'm moving the knee by the knee, if I'm at the knee joint, if I'm giving a say 30 degree or a 40 degree motion, we're first giving it to the contours here. And that is the third step here, contour transformation. What we did earlier, that we did a Delaunay mapping in which the space, the volume of the body was mapped into a set of tetrahedrons. That information is used along with this contour information to do a remapping later so that we are able to transform the flesh as well. This is similar to what we talked of in the morning. We have a contour seal and the contours are being generated. Okay, and for doing the contour transformation, our techniques are different for each joint. Essentially, they're based on the fact that each contour is practically been given an affine transformation. Okay, that means the contours are going through simple rigid body transformations, but as a result, the whole body, I mean the soft tissues, they are being deformed according to the need of the situation. Okay. So the interface that we have, we have two kinds of interfaces. Essentially, we can import the target files being generated in the other methods. So if the targets are being generated through the positioning module that has been presented right now, we can take those target files and then use that in this interface to reposition the model. Okay, so if what that means is that if let's say in that repositioning module, five different joints have been moved, then when we go through this, when we start positioning using the targets, for each of those five, we will reposition using the contours one by one. Alternatively, what we can do here is that for the different joints of the body, we can pick the joints one by one and accordingly give the angular input at that joint and position at that and reposition the model at that joint. These are some of the results, but I'll come back to this. I'll first show the demos because they are more expressive. So this So in this particular video, what we are doing is we're first generating the targets, and then after generating the targets, we are importing them into the contour deformation module, and then running them. The first part of it is for generating the target, which has already been explained by the previous speakers. So to cut on the time, I'll skip that and go. So at this point, the targets are being created. Okay. The targets are exported into a file. And then we launch the contour deformation module. Okay. We go into the positioning module in this, and we first load the contour CL file, because that is the skeleton which we are using for all our purposes. And then we have loaded the target file as well. Okay. Okay. Sometimes we give some messages about missing metadata. For the timing, you can ignore that. So now we say start positioning using the targets. Okay, so So the moment we click on start positioning using the targets, it tells us which is the first joint it is going to reposition. Right now it is giving a message that the first joint it wants to reposition is the neck joint. Okay, continue from that. And for that we generate the contours, we deform the contours, and we reposition. Okay, so neck has been repositioned now. Okay, after that I can click on process the next target, or the next joint we should be calling it actually. Okay, so first we reposition at the neck joint, now we'll reposition at the next joint, whichever is, so this is the wrist joint we're taking up now. Let me just tell you that sometimes you find these extraneous lines coming in between. Those are, there is a bug, but that does not affect the workflow. It does not create an error in the results right now. So you can ignore that if you get such a thing at the moment. Okay, so the wrist has been repositioned. Then the next joint is the elbow joint that is being repositioned. Okay, we go through the same process. Okay, so elbow has also been repositioned, and the other wrist is being repositioned again. Okay, so when all the inputs that came from the target module, when they have been taken care of, it gives a message that the repositioning is complete. And we can stop at that. Okay. So this shows the repositioned module from the model from different angles. Okay. Let me show a video for the repositioning of the knee joint for the child model. Incidentally, the metadata for the child model is at the moment incomplete, so that is not being supplied in the USB stick today, but. It'll soon be completed before the final completion of the project. So we'll just show the repositioning at one of the joints for the child model. So this is the left knee that is being repositioned by say 25 degrees. Again, we go through the same steps. We generate the contours, deform it, and you can see that the contours have been deformed now. And then we do a repositioning. The knee is reformed as well. Okay. So I'll not interrupt this one. Let this continue. In this, what we are doing is that we are going to reposition this GHBMC model for multiple joints, one after another. Okay, so we can select, let's say, the elbow joint position, give the angular input for that. We go through the repositioning of the angle of the elbow joint. Once that is done, then we go on to the next joint and so on. Some of the things that we have implemented in this is that the inputs that we are giving at every joint, I mean the motion that we are giving at every joint, that is being controlled by the clinical information we have about that joint. For instance, at some particular joints, we have motion which is known that exists. For example, at the knee joint, we have a patellar movement. So how much is the patellar movement that is expected? We have taken a priori knowledge of that. So the patellar movement is being controlled by the knowledge that we have from clinical literature. Okay, so things like that have been incorporated. And as you run this model, you'll also get messages sometimes that if you are trying to, let's say, reposition the knee beyond permissible limits. Okay, those permissible limits could be either because of clinical information, that means the knee is not supposed to flex to that extent normally, or it could also be because the model is not stable at those angles at the moment. So in both those cases, you might get a message saying that such a thing is not permitted. So we've repositioned the knee joint, now the ankle is being repositioned. So we give a value for the how much motion is needed at the ankle joint. Okay. for the spine, what we do is we can take the target inputs from the spine controller. So whatever vertebral positions have been obtained from the spine controller, they can be taken into this, and each of the vertebra will be positioned according to the output from the spine controller. Alternatively, in this at this joint, we can pick the spinal joints. Typically, we have taken the spine into three parts, which is the lumbar part, thoracic part, and the cervical part. For each of them, we are doing a cubic interpolation, and we take the lumbar angle or the thoracic angle or the cervical angle as the input, and then we can reposition using that as well. Let me just see how much more time is needed here. Yeah, it's coming to an end in a minute or two. Okay. Yeah, so for the neck also, we can take the input to be in any of the three directions. That means we can give a flexion extension, we can give a lateral flexion, and we can also give a twisting angle for any of the three spinal joints as well. Okay, so this model has been modified at multiple places. For example, at the knee joint, at the ankle joint, the neck has also been repositioned, the arms have been repositioned, the wrist has been repositioned, and so on and so forth. Okay. So this gives you an overview of how we are doing the repositioning using the contour-based approach. I think I'll stop here, and the next speaker.